You are reliable, reliable. Thank you. soul doth magnify the Lord.
Chapter 12, verse 22 to 25. The Bible says, "But ye have come to Mount Zion." Brethren, this morning you have come to where? Mount Zion. "And to the city of the living God, heavenly Jerusalem, and to the myriads of angels, the universal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, and to God, judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, mediator of a new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling, speaking better than Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaks. For if those did not escape who had refused him who uttered the oracles on earth, much more we who turn away from him who does so from heaven." Brethren, you have come to Mount Zion this morning. It's the mount of the Lord of hosts. Amen? So our first revelation and sharing this morning will be on the topic, the Lord of hosts. And I hand over to Pastor Forbes to give us that blessing through the word.
Good morning. is none like you. No one else can touch our lives like you. We can search through all eternity long and can find there is none like you. There is none like you. Trust we could have put our lives could never have sustained us thus far. You are the only God. You are the Most High God. There is none like you. There is none beside you, Father. And our times and our lives are in your hands. This morning, we have come to Mount Zion, to tabernacle, to dwell, to stay in full possession of our possessions, in full covering of the glory. We have come to receive the blessings of those who dwell in Mount Zion and see the terror of those who come against those who stay in Mount Zion. We have come to declare that you are great and greatly to be praised. We have come to see the defense of your glory. And this morning we have come to you, the Lord of hosts, who dwells in Mount Zion. Break the bread of life before us, Holy Spirit, and let this awesome presence take us to a place where it will be all of you and none of us. And everything that you will reveal this morning and manifest by your glory and your power, may your name be praised. In the wonderful and precious name of Jesus, my Savior. And all together the people said, Amen. Mount Zion has its inhabitants. Mount Zion has its owner. The owner of Mount Zion, the one who decides what happens in Mount Zion, is called the Lord of hosts. Or he is called Yahweh Sabaoth, or Jehovah Sabaoth. Sabaoth meaning hosts. Hosts meaning the entirety of the armies of heaven and on the earth. the Lord of hosts. When we are introduced to God in Genesis chapter 1, we're introduced to him in a particular attribute of his almightiness, yet that not being the totality of his almightiness. And because we have learned that revelation is progressive, we see that from Genesis 1:1 to our today and for all eternity, the progression of the revelation of who God is, which progression in its entirety cannot be known on this earth until we see him face to face, is open for us to be able to walk in a different path from how we have walked. So this morning, I don't know how I will end, but I will start this way. Genesis 1:1, the word used there is Elohim, which we all know. It's a plural word, like cherub and cherubim, seraph and seraphim, Elo and Elohim. And the professors would probably want to tell you that the word is gods. And some people use that to establish the Trinity or the Godhead, that Elohim is the plural form of God. That's why Genesis 1:26, it says, let us make man. It's the speaking of the Godhead and the speaking of royalty and kingship. So Elohim is introduced to us as God. And Elohim can be stretched in all kinds of angles, but in its descriptive definition, it is the creative part of God. So we are introduced to a creating God who releases his creativity upon us, as Pastor Nimi blessed us yesterday evening with. And when you journey in your Bible from Genesis 1, that name keeps coming in various forms. It graduates to the Lord God Almighty. That name, apart from being Elohim, translates into a name we all are familiar with called El Shaddai or El Shaddai, the Lord God Almighty, the all-sufficient one, the one who nourishes, the one who brings fertility, the one who is self-existent in himself, the one who is more than enough, or the one who is double-breasted. He can suckle triplets and quintuplets and nations, and his milk never runs dry. His name is the Lord God Almighty. And that's how he introduced himself to Abraham in Genesis 17 and in other places, when he knocked on Abraham's door after Abraham had refused to take the spoil from the people who were going to give him and then tell him they made him king. God told him, because you have stayed in uprightness and righteousness, walk before me and be blameless. I am the Lord God Almighty. I am the all-sufficient one. And so the revelation of God that you have is the revelation of God that you walk with. Everybody knows about God. Even those who believe, they don't believe in God, know about God. So they know him in his creative, passive way for them. There's no active relationship. And truth be told, until a particular transition based on the almightiness of God's counsel, God was known as Jehovah Elohim. Was known as Elohim, the Lord God Almighty. And then Moses comes into the picture. And God, long story short, is sending Moses on an errand. And God introduces himself to Moses in a different form in Exodus chapter 6, verse 3. And that verse says something to this effect, that I was known to them as the Lord God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. Now, I won't dare to touch that because the institution himself is seated here. But let me throw the words to you. You've had the word tetragrammaton, the four letters that the Jews could not talk about, the YHWH, from which they put some vowels and it became Yahweh, which translates into Jehovah. So from his creative acts in Exodus chapter 2, because he's now becoming personally involved in the life of a man and the life of a family and the life of the nation and then finally the life of the world, he transforms into his covenant relationship. So we now start addressing him as Jehovah Mikdash, the Lord our sanctifier, Jehovah Tsidkenu or Tsidkenu, the Lord our righteousness, and every experience that people had with him, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Nisi, Gideon called him, Jehovah Shammah, the end of Ezekiel chapter 48, the Lord is there. His name comes up, the Lord is my shepherd, Jehovah Rohi, the Lord is my healer, Jehovah Rapha, and so many other names come up. And even if you go around West Africa, people have all kinds of names for him, Jehovah Swagalicious, Jehovah this, Jehovah that, Jehovah that, because that whatever he is preceded by his covenant relationship. And with that covenant relationship, you rest assured that what he said he's going to do, he's going to do. So he translates from his creative acts into his covenant relationship. So people know him as God, God the creator. And some people who even define him in their own way, even though they may be actually talking about an idol, talk about his creative ability, but they don't know him on a one-to-one fellowship reality as Jehovah. So he proceeds, and you get to a place in the New Testament, because we have three messages, so I have to run fast, when Saul, who was a religious personality, zealous, sincere, but wrong, and swore on the oath of his fathers that he would protect what was given to him, and this newfound born-again thing that's going on is too noisy. Why is church like this? Why do they clap? Where do they dance? The Lord is in his holy temple, let the whole earth be afraid of him. You know the things they used to tell us. And Saul had an encounter with him. Strange encounter. Saul was going with his men, and in his testimony to King Agrippa, he said, "We all saw the light, but I was the only one that had the voice. And the voice that spoke to me after the light shone on me said, Saul, Saul, the light knew me by my name. The voice from the light knew me by my name. Call me by my name and ask me, why are you persecuting me?" And Saul's answer was, "Who art thou, Lord?" That word Lord is Adonai. And so as you look at the various names of Lord God, you see them being relating to people's experiences. As long as Saul was able to identify in his rebellious nature that this is not just a light, this is not just chemistry, this is not just echo effect from a sound boom, this is Lord, this is Adonai, and he got saved. Now when we come to our own lives, a lot of us here, almost everybody, is of an African origin. I know in Ghana, for example, when you hear them sing, they use a word, Onyankopon. Onyankopon is translated the owner of the heaven and the earth. You cannot miss who that is. If you come to the Gambia in the Wolof, from where you have jollof rice, when they want to talk, they say Borombi. Borombi means the owner. If you say, "Can I Borombi?" Who owns this? Borom is owner. So, apart from just saying Yala, which we all know, some people even say Allah, which is not the God that created the heavens and the earth. When they say Borombi, Borom is owner. In Mandinka, from where you have Kunta Kinte, where Roots came from, it's a village in my country called Jufure. That word is Mario. Mario also means owner. So in the mind of the person who is speaking, when you say Borombi, like when somebody passes on or dies and they read the obituary in the local language, they say Boromamyo Jelmako. The owner, his owner has taken him back. You don't say it's the ancestors. You don't say it's the demon of the village. You know that the owner is the owner. He is the Lord. He is Onyankopon. He owns the heavens and the earth. And he alone qualifies for that. When you come to the Lord Jesus, if he is God, then he is worshipped as God because he is God. And he also has all kinds of names. You cannot mistake somebody for Alpha and Omega as a God of 700 years. You cannot mistake somebody as beginning and end. You cannot mistake somebody as the strength of the arm of Israel. These are different names, and they are all related to the part of his covenant being for our lives. So also in some of our songs, Jehovah is your name, Jehovah is your name, mighty warrior, great in battle. And everybody seated here who sings that song, know that when you sing that song, it's like you tickle God. He knows that war is a war cry. It's not even a song of worship. It's a war cry. It's like my big God. It's not my small God. So everybody knows we're not talking about the demon in your family. We're not talking about the Indian God in the restaurant. We're not talking about the Hibachi God. We're talking about the owner of the heavens and the earth. He is Alpha. He is Omega. So also, he is called the Lord of hosts. By definition, it means that every physical, every thing around power belongs to him. The host there, typically defined, relate to the angels. And because this is not a teaching this morning on angels, even though I've delved into that, you know that there are categories from what we have read in the Bible. Some people have gone beyond the Bible, but I like to stay in the Bible. We see that God seated in the heavenlies, seated in the throne of glory. We see him in Isaiah 6. We see him in Revelations 1 and 2. We see him typified in Exodus 25, downwards in the tabernacle. He is seated, and around him are two classes of angels for starters. One class is called the cherubim. The cherubim are the group of angels we are taught, of which Lucifer was one, by the way, that guard his glory. So he shares it with no one, or let me put it rightly, he doesn't share it with another. That's what the Bible says. Not no man, we popularly say no man, but it says with another. So because the glory of God is so special, the glory of God can fry you. When the glory descended in the tabernacle, everybody fell down. The strongest man who stood astride Moses, when God was coming, everything had to bow. Hallelujah. So his glory is guarded by the cherubim. And then another attribute of who he is his holiness, which is how we get into Mount Zion, as you found that. And that holiness, that qualitative characteristic which is specific to God, without which no man can see him, is guarded by another set of angels called the seraphim. Seraph 1, theme 2, and more. And so, if you can picture in your mind's eye, there's this throne of splendor and beauty that can be, that cannot be described with human language. You know, the precious metals, the stones, the beauty, the aesthetics, it's not given to man. We can just speak of it, but it's like clearer than clearest, clearer, clearest, clearer, clearest diamond. And so, this seraphim guard his holiness, and this cherubim guard his glory. And also there are archangels. We have been introduced to Michael, who when you get into trouble, he will come and deal with princes and deal with issues. There is Gabriel, we are also told, who brings good news. And there are also other kinds of angels and archangels. And the Bible calls them the thousands of the thousands of the myriads of the thousands, innumerable. And they all make up the host. Somewhere in the book of Revelation, if you look for it, I'll be glad when you find it, there is an angel that the Bible says when he came down, he put one foot on the sea and he put another foot on the land. So check the sheer size of those beings. One of his foot or feet was on sea, the other one was on land. And that's one angel. Maybe not even an archangel. Maybe not to the order of cherubim or seraphim. And all them with their strength and their power, they fly faster than the speed of light. They do so many things that we cannot understand. The Bible says that they make up the host in however you can imagine their power. God, in the midst of them, he is the Lord of hosts. Secondly, God is the creator of all these angels and us. And so Isaiah, one day, bit of a sad story, but better late than never, like we say, King Uzziah, it's like his uncle or so, had to die for Isaiah to now lift up his eye and know that his needs are not from his job or his uncle's connections or the heirloom and bequeathment, but he must look at the Lord. And Isaiah testified and says in Isaiah 6 that in the year, not in the day, but in the year, I don't know how long it took for him in that 1 year, but in that year that King Uzziah died, he said, I saw the Lord. And this is description. He said, I saw the Lord. The Lord was high and lifted up. He was lofty. He was seated at the throne. And the robe of his temple, the robe of holiness and righteousness, filled the entire temple. And there were angels around him. And one of those groupings of angels we talked about were there. They were called the seraphim. And he describes this seraph one. He said each one of them had six wings. He said two of the wings they took to cover their face because they could not look into the glory of the Almighty God, Lord of hosts, even though they themselves had glory. Because you cannot stay in the presence of God and not have glory. But the brilliance of God's glory was greater than the collective glory of the angels, that it overpowered them. They had to cover their eyes and could not look into the brilliance of God's glory. The other two wings, they covered their feet and they said, we cannot take steps in this place because if God does not move, we must not move. Jesus said, I do not do things until I see my Father doing them. How dare I be presumptuous and make a move when God has not? So I'd rather take my wings and cover my feet so that my walk life and my looking life are preempted by God speaking. But then they had other two. And those two out of six, which is 33 1/3%, they used to fly and to move. There could be a deeper revelation here for a lot of us that before we move, we have covered our eyes not to look in the flesh, and we have covered our feet not to be presumptuous, and we are waiting for the Lord to give the instruction, we move. Most people might move with four out of the six, but the Lord has called us to move with the two out of the six. Now look at this. The Bible says, if you picture this, there are thousands and billions of these angels, and they are all there with their brilliance. So you can imagine what God can look like on his throne. And it says they were calling one to another. A seraph was calling a fellow seraph, and the seraph was answering the seraph. It was like a call and response. And the angels were saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, the God of the owner of the earth, the mighty God. He is holy. He is separated. He is all in a class by himself. He is the one that owns Mount Zion. He is the one that when he defends us by his glory, nothing can happen to us because his holiness is greater than anything. And so some time ago, I taught this many years ago at the Marriott. Can you imagine billions of angels crying forward and backwards? Holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. Kadosh, 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 Jehovah Shabbat, Kadosh, Kadosh, Kadosh. And a glory came into that place. And Isaiah said, my God, this is what I was missing. Yes, this is what you are missing, Isaiah, because you are dwelling at the lowlands. The Lord is calling us up in this Lily's Leadership Church. Leaders, come up to Mount Zion, because there is a place where the honor is, where his holiness, his power, his glory, his righteousness flows upon our life. He is Jehovah, the Lord of hosts. Somebody shout, the Lord of hosts. He dwells in Mount Zion. You cannot dwell in that presence and be afraid. You cannot dwell in that presence and be dismayed. You cannot dwell in that presence and wonder what is going to happen, because the Lord has worked it out. He has you covered by his glory, by his holiness, by his power, by the blood, by the name, by the word, by everything we know, because he's a host and the Lord of the armies of Israel. Hallelujah. Let me take you elsewhere. All glory to God. Ah, thank you, Father. Psalm 46. It was David that said, God is our refuge and God is our strength. Can somebody say that to the Lord with me? God is my refuge and God is my strength. Again, that is, we can read it, but it's not for the ordinary. It's for the brother, the sister, for the people who have come to Mount Zion. Because apart from it saying our very present help in trouble, even though the mountains be moved and be carried into the midst of the sea, there is a city, there is a river whose city makes glad the children of God. God is in the midst of us, she shall not be moved. Then it says, the Lord of hosts is with us. And yesterday we learned that he is also the God of Jacob. Why Jacob? We talked that yesterday. The God of Jacob is our refuge. The Lord of hosts is with us. Somebody lift up your hand and say, the Lord of hosts is with me. For I have come to Mount Zion. I don't know what's happening in your spirit this morning, but shout, the Lord of hosts is with me. The Lord of hosts is with me. The Lord of hosts is with me. The Lord of hosts with us. And the God of Jacob is our refuge. So we do not walk like mere men. We do not walk in the ordinary. People may think we are walking by ourselves, but the Lord of hosts is ahead of us. His glory is ahead of the world. If you look on the left and look on the right, everywhere we are, we are protected by the Lord of hosts. Hallelujah. In Psalm 24, you remember, he said, the earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, and all that. And then he got to a point and he said, lift up your head, O ye gates, and be lifted up, you eternal doors. Why? For the King of glory is about to come in. And there was a question, who is this King of glory? We don't know him. And the answer was, the Lord strong and mighty in battle. And the gates were still locked. And he said again, lift up your head, O ye gates, and be lifted up, you eternal doors. It's not a suggestion. We're not discussing this. It's a commandment. And they said, but who is this King of glory? We don't have his name in our Monday visitors list. We doesn't have a visitor's pass. He doesn't need to be a visitor. He's the owner. He's the Lord of hosts. Like Jesus told Joshua, I am not for you left or right. I am the captain. I am Jehovah Sabaoth. I'm the Lord of the hosts. I am God. I am Onyakupo. I am Bottom B. I am Mario. I am the owner. They said, who is this King of glory? Then the answer came, if you don't understand him as the Lord God, strong and mighty in battle, let me tell you, he is the Lord of hosts. And ladies and gentlemen, when you call him the Lord of hosts, I think you tickle something in God. And he rises, who is worrying your life? And the hosts come. People wonder how we are preserved. People wonder how certain things happen to us. They have it so planned so well, and you walk through their plan unscathed, and they wonder how. They say, oh, he's smart. I think in Sennacherib's battles, the man told him that their God is a God of the mountain. Let's fight them again in the hill. He is mountain, hill, and everything. He is the Lord of hosts. Let me give you two more so I can leave you. Goliath. 1 Samuel 17, Goliath had literally harassed Israel. And Israel's story was funny because Saul already was head and shoulders above everybody. David's brothers were already Israeli men fighting. And Goliath just came out this day for 40 days, we're told. Every day he said, I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man. This is going to be a representative battle. Let him fight on your behalf and I will fight for the Philistines. If he kills me, my people will serve you. But if I kill him, which I am likely to do, you will serve me for the rest of your life. And everybody was afraid. Because they could see his man was like 10 feet, had six fingers on each hand. His arm had his armor, his shield had to be carried by another man who was probably shaking. And then in the ordinariness of how God does things, Jesse called David and said, go to the battlefront, take some cheese, some milk, some yogurt for your brothers. And David went, and while David was there, he heard Goliath was cursing. And David said, what is the love offering for this kind of preaching? What will you do? And they said, well, the king has said this, and our king has also said that. And while this discussion was going on, Goliath opened his mouth and made the tragic mistake of his life. The Bible says he cursed them by his gods. And as I heard somebody say recently, if he had not touched that area of his gods, which is the supernatural, maybe all would have been well for him. But once he said, I curse you by my gods, then David said, my own God will also rise up. So David looked at him and said, you come to me again, you come against me with a spear and sword. I come to you in the name of the Lord of, help me, hosts of the armies of Israel whom you have defied. So the mistake you made in touching us is that you did not touch us. You touched the apple of God's eye. He had already told us, touch not mine anointed. Do my prophets no harm. They have paid the price. I have seen what Job has gone through. I have seen what Paul has gone through. That is why Paul can say, according to my gospel. And we cannot criticize him for being a heretic, because it's now a personal reality in his life. It is my gospel. And David said, oh, you call your gods? I would also call my God. My God owns everything plus you and your God. And David chose a little stone, and the rest was history. He took that stone and he hit it, and I personally believe the host helped the stone to find where Goliath was probably laughing, and his visor was open and it went straight to him. That is what the Lord of hosts can do for us. So because we have come to Mount Zion, we have possessed our possessions. We are not possessing possessions because we see them. We have already possessed them. We have called them from wherever they are in all the 14 ways we are taught. We've used power. We've used privilege. And we are still using prophecy with the promise attached to it. And we are coming in a relationship with the Holy Spirit in a trinity of peace, which is a righteous peace. We've also come before the Lord and praised him like nobody else. Harp, timbre, tambourine, sound, breath. Everything in the sanctuary, in the firmament, the environment of his power, in the atmosphere that makes God come down as the Lord of hosts. We have also seen that his glory defends us in everything, but we got to be in Mount Zion. The glory does not defend us down in the valley. We have to come to that place where the atmosphere is Edenic, where it's Zionic, where it's the rest of God. And now, he's reminding us that we just do not go there by ourselves to loiter. There is an owner. And if there is an owner, there is a constitution. And if there are constitutions, there are laws of how we operate in this Mount Zion, so that the Lord of hosts can manifest his power over our lives. I believe when Psalm 2 was written, that was the same thinking in the mind of David. Why do the heathen rage? And they still rage. And we still ask the question, why are they raging? Why would you rage against something you cannot do anything about? You can't change anything about God. You can't change God's counsel. This is how he describes himself. I do all things according to the counsel of my will. And my counsel shall stand. Psalm 33 verse 6 downwards, he overturns the counsels of nations. Why do the heathen rage? And why do the people imagine a vain thing? They say they will set themselves against the Lord and his anointed and see what they can do. And the Bible says, he that sits in the heavens, he just laughs. If you sit down and imagine that you have the Creator on your side, you have Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Rophe, Jehovah El Shaddai, Jehovah Adonai, Jehovah First and Last, Jehovah Alpha and Omega. You have Jesus, the Word, the Blood, the Power, the Name. You have the Lord of Hosts. You even have the angels. We cannot fail. And so he just laughs. He says, these people, if I open two pipes, I will dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. And so the warning came up prophetically, kiss the son, lest he be angry. And in his anger, you will perish in the way. Because he's a jealous God. He doesn't share his glory with another. That is part of his Sabaoth nature. He calls the angels to come on our behalf. I believe Psalm 91 has bits of it too. When we dwell under the shadow of the Almighty, when we dwell and abide in the secret place, is part of that Mount Zion preservation that we have. And so as I begin to conclude, look at your life and remember that the Lord invited us from all walks of life, from different continents, to come so that he brings us into Mount Zion. so that we don't go back. We stay in Mount Zion. There is nothing the earth in itself can tell us that Mount Zion does not know. When Israel was in sin and they were doing that calf, God from heaven told Moses, go down and look at what your people are doing. So heaven already knows information before earth tells us what it is. So he's called us to this place. And Psalm 46 tells us the Lord of hosts is with us. In this season, it's not just that God is with us. We will get there December 25 and switch it to Emmanuel. But it's the Lord of hosts. I want to challenge us with the permission of Pastor Elsie that when you get to certain places, just say the Lord of hosts is here. There are some issues that are just senseless. You have done all you can do. In my language, we have what we call sabari. That is okay. It's all right. Ejo. Okay. I am sorry. I am wrong. Please forgive me. And there are people who won't just take it. They want to fight. When you get to that point, I believe you must call upon the Lord of hosts. You know why? So that God will put a final answer to it. There's a scripture in Hebrews that says, with two immutable things with which it's impossible for God to lie, that you lay rest this issue. It's not going to happen again. There are some issues like we have prayed. There are some issues we have confessed. There are some issues we are trusting God. But there are some issues we must now get into that realm from Mount Zion and call the Lord of hosts. And God is not going to run short of angels. He's not going to run short of power. He's not going to say, well, wait for 15 minutes. A lot of angels have gone to the Gambia. I need them to come back and refresh them. They have a day off before they can come to America. No. Jesus said, I can call my Father now. A legion can come, that was 12 legions or so, about 72,000. While you are doing it, they are crying in the Gambia for respite. Kenya is crying for respite. The Cubans are not sure what's going to happen to them. There are many, and God is not saying that, okay, let's go to the book. You go there, and let's withdraw that one and send him to there, and the driver take that there, and let this one overlap that one. There are thousands, and ladies and gentlemen, if he is who he is, even if the angels don't want to do it, he will step out of eternity into time. And when he steps into time, he does not lose his eternal nature. He is the same God yesterday, today, forever. So wherever you are, whatever it is, even in my life, let's start talking to the God who is the Lord of Sabaoth, who is the God of the host of the armies of Israel. Let's connect to what David connected. Let's connect to what David connected. Let's connect to what David connected. Goliath in the flesh, you cannot beat him. But with the Lord of hosts, all kinds of things can happen. So the angels that guard our homes and the angel of the Lord that encamps around our dwelling was sent by the Lord of hosts. Was not sent to watch TV. Was not sent to buy bread. If they were sent by the Lord of hosts, they are on an assignment. At some other time, maybe Gabriel can be sent to give you good news. So take the good news. At another time, in your own, you have prayed because you've come to a revelation of the books like Daniel. And you thought, my gosh, I'm on the verge of prophecy fulfillment. I'm going to take a 21-day time and I'm going to pray. I'm going to fast. I'm going to make some major giving in my life. And you do it and your spirit tells you all is okay. And even if your spirit doesn't tell you, you know that God is not a man that he should lie. His word is exalted to the status of his name or even above his name. And something seems not to be happening right. We are not told in Daniel that he called for the Lord of hosts. But I'm saying this morning, call for the Lord of hosts. And then Michael was sent. And Michael was not sent for good news. He was not sent to bring food. He was not sent for anything else. He had to clear the atmosphere. And he came and he cleared it. And he told Daniel, from the first day you prayed, it is not Jehovah Jireh that answered you. It is not Jehovah Nissi that answered you. It is not Elohim El Shaddai. It is Jehovah Sabaoth. I have heard Pastor Nemi say, I have heard Pastor Elsie say over and over, whatever you call God, that is what he will be to you. Some situations this morning And for the rest of these 40-something days of 2016, and as we approach 2017, need Jehovah Sabaoth. If we were going to say God's covenant names were going to lose power, I will say that Jehovah Jireh, the level is now low, because we are asking all the time, give me Lord, give me Lord, give me Lord. And Sabaoth is right there. And very few people are using Sabaoth. You know why? Because very few people have dared to go to Mount Zion. Because until you get to Mount Zion, you cannot encounter Sabaoth. And ladies and gentlemen, as great as some of the things that we need are, one of them is called the children's bread. You cannot live by bread alone. So you must climb beyond bread and get to the weightier matters of the law, where on account of the destinies of nations and the destinies of dominions and thrones, and on account of Matthew 24:14 coming to pass, that the kingdom of the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to the end of the world as a sign before the end come. On account of that, on account of your purpose, on account of the prophecy that Eileen has given us, on account of the prophecies we have had and the written prophecy in the word of God, you now come to Jehovah Sabaoth and warfare, so you can create territory and make room for yourself. And if God helps you, you make a generational room for the gospel of the kingdom. Bow your heads in prayer. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Let's not mince matters about it. He's the Lord of hosts. He's Kabiyosi. Is Mario the owner? The cherubim serve him. The seraphim serve him. And if you are coming this morning for the first time in this conference, we're inviting you to climb with us to Mount Zion and experience deliverance like never before, and choose holiness and be ready to possess your possessions. And see the glory of heaven that covers the dwellings, the visions, the dreams in Mount Zion, and the assemblies of the remnant, and that tabernacle of the Most High God. The Lord of hosts is with us. The Lord of hosts is with me. Jehovah Sabaoth of the armies of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. Connect with him in a newer way today. He will give his angels charge over me. Go beyond that. That is Jireh, my provider. Go to Sabaoth, and he fights for me. And at the mention of his name, the gates open and the everlasting doors are lifted up for his glorious entrance. Jehovah, the man of war.
You are God all by yourself.
thank you, Lord God Almighty, for your God from beginning to the end. You are the Ancient of Days. You are the Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and the end. You are everything. Apart from you, there is nothing. Apart from our union with you, we are nothing. But in you, we are kings and priests. We are everything. We are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, called out of darkness to show forth the praises of him who's called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. But today, Lord, we just want to thank you for lifting us up where we belong. Mount Zion is our home. Hallelujah. Thank you for bringing us back home this morning. We thank you, Lord God Almighty, for the lowlands are no longer for us. Thank you, Lord God Almighty, for it is settled, it is settled, it is settled. Holy Father, we glorify your holy name, for you've now placed us in a fortress. Fortress of God, the Mount of God, and that's where our address is. The secret place of the Most High, the shadow of the Almighty, the place of our refuge, the place of our fortress. We're there, Lord, because you carried us there, because you brought us there. Glory be to your holy name, O Lord. Glory be to your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Our topic, second topic this morning, is on the topic, the portion of those that come against, the portion of those that fight against Mount Zion. The portion of the enemies of Mount Zion. First of all, so we all have a clear understanding of where we're going. Zion is our, up on Mount Zion is our theme for Word of Wisdom this year. Up on Mount Zion. And so we first need to understand that Zion means a fortress. Zion means what? A fortress. And when we say we are upon Mount Zion, in essence, we are saying we are standing upon the mountain that is a fortress. We're standing upon Mount Zion. And the portion of those that come against Mount Zion, against Zion, is that first of all, they are fighting against a mountain. People who are wise leave a mountain alone. Maybe you can step all over the valley. Maybe you can climb a hill. But a mountain, when you want to get on a mountain to fight against it, even to get on the mountain, it's not easy, but to fight against anyone who is on Mount Zion is a portion of those who are unwise and foolish. The Word of God is very clear. Let's go to the book of Psalms. If we encounter the Word of God, all over the Psalms, Zion is mentioned. But I'd like us to focus on a few of them so we will have a peace in our hearts. Psalm 125, I'll take first. It says, they that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abided forever. So when you come against Mount Zion, you're fighting against that which cannot be removed, but abided forever. The only foolish people do that. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people from henceforth, even forever. For the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous, lest the righteous put forth their hands into iniquity. Do good, O Lord, unto those that be good, and to them that are upright in their hearts. As for such as turn aside unto their crooked ways, the Lord shall lead them forth with the workers of iniquity. People who walk against Mount Zion, God who owns Mount Zion will lead them forth with the workers of iniquity, but peace shall be upon Israel. The first portion of those who come against Mount Zion is that they keep company with those who walk iniquity. You find out that there are people who their whole scenario, their mode of operation is undercurrent. They smile above, they operate below. And because they are such, they keep company with people who have defiled hearts. So they keep company with those who walk iniquity. Iniquity is repeated, unrepentant, sinful nature. So there are certain people who, if, for instance, someone has the iniquity of lying, they cannot help it but lie. The first punishment God gives to people who come against Mount Zion is he gives them a company of people who are in iniquity, who naturally lie, who naturally plot, who naturally plan evil. And that's who they keep company with. You see, when God honors you, he will upgrade your fellowship. He will upgrade the people you meet. He will give, you know, there are people you meet and they challenge you and they provoke you to progress. There are people you meet, you know they are taking you down, but the slide down is easier than the climb up. And so I pray that God will deliver us from any thought whatsoever that will cause us to want to come against the work of God. Because what God is doing in every life, in every generation, the total picture belongs to God. But if in your little mind you just think, I can come against this way, who will know what I'm doing? It is difficult to fight against an invisible God.